midweek service. Hump day. Amen. Praise God. Give God praise and thanks for allowing us to be together one more time.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for all that you do. You're awesome, perfect, and all your ways, God. We praise you, Lord, for who you are. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Give honor to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
Another night. Praise God. Your week was like my week. You should be excited to be here tonight.
Amen.
Should be excited to be tuned in tonight. Praise God. Putting everything aside and just giving time out for God. Amen. You can never give God too much time. Praise God. So tonight, let's just focus on this Bible study. Let's focus on our worship. Let's focus on what you've come here to do today. Amen. And let's give God the fullest praise. No matter if it's a low-key service like this, let's give God the fullest praise. Can we do that?
All
right. Praise God. Heavenly Father, you're awesome in all your ways, Lord. We're thanking you, God, in advance, God, for the things that you're going to do. We need you, God, in our lives, God. We need your spirit to give us that comfort, that peace, Lord, that only you can give. Lord, I thank you, God, for all the good things that you're going for us. I thank you, God, for all the blessings, Lord, all the miracles, the mercy that you've given to us, God. Lord, continue to work in our lives. In the name of Jesus, let's worship him tonight.
I'm a friend of God.
Every breath that I
Are you going to be there? Are you going to be there? Amen. If you don't know, amen. You better get to know.
You better
praise God. Amen. I want to make sure I'm there.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Praise God. That's what this is all about, guys.
Yeah, man.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's what this is all about. We're coming to church tonight not to look for our friends. We're not coming to church to eat. Amen. Praise God. Which that does help sometimes. Amen. But we come to church so we can get closer to God. Praise God. And if you're here for that reason, amen, let's just invite God's presence. Amen. Not just here, but into our hearts tonight. Amen. God has a special word for each and every one of us. Amen. We just got to be willing to receive it. Praise God. Amen. As we look around us, there's lots of things going on around this world. You can be seated. Amen. Amen. And we don't have the answers. Amen. We don't know sometimes where to get our answers from. Amen. Praise God. We can't buy them. We can't, amen, find them. Praise God. But I know where we can get them. Amen. That's good prayer. And that's what we want to do here tonight. We want to go to God in prayer tonight. Amen. I know there's a lot of heavy hearts here tonight. Amen. I know that, let's keep Nathan
Acres
in prayer. Let's keep that family in prayer tonight. Amen. A lot of situations going on. COVID's taking a lot of people, getting a lot of people sick. Amen. That's why we're wearing these things. Amen. Trying to avoid that. Praise God, but amen, it's out there. And we just want to pray for those that, amen, are getting struck by this. Amen. A lot of people are dying from it. Amen. A lot of our brother and sister are dying from it. Praise God. But we have a God that He knows the end.
Yes, He does, bro.
No matter what the situation might look like here tonight, no matter what your personal situation might look like, God knows what your end is. Amen. And even if He doesn't take COVID away, guess what? He can give us the peace to get through it. Amen. If I get it, well, God, I pray that you would heal me. But if not, praise God, we're going to go to a place one day where we're not going to have no sicknesses, no diseases, no more COVID.
That's right, man.
Praise God. Amen. Yeah. Is there anyone else that has a prayer request?
I want to pray for my mom and dad. They had their second COVID shot yesterday, and they're not feeling well today.
Amen. Pray for our First Lady's parents. Praise God. Over in North Carolina. Jesus. Terry, amen. That family in prayer right now. Amen. Another COVID situation. Amen. Praise God. It's going to be a common story, amen, for a while to come yet. Praise God. God's able.
My parents are looking for a house, and just the market is really crazy. They're looking for a house, because everybody's bidding, and you've got five and six people on one house, so I'm praying that they find the house that God wants for
them. Amen. Okay. Praise God. I'll lift them up today. Amen. God cares about house finding.
Yes, He does.
Amen. Praise God. But,
I think I overheard that there was an accident where someone was a minister's daughter or somebody.
Pastor Lois down in Texas, right?
Let's pray for people in Texas right now.
Right. Amen. 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 Let's pray for our country. Amen. Pastor, put the request out for the people in Texas. Amen. A lot of storms, a lot of people aren't ready for this kind of, this magnitude of weather that they hit them. Amen. Let's just pray that God covers His people. Praise God. Amen. We know He's able.
Yes, He is.
Amen.
My Uncle Santana, he's still in the hospital with COVID.
Okay, all right. Uncle Santana. Praise God. All right. All right. Amen. A lot of needs. Amen. Go ahead, sis.
We're not flying home tomorrow because of the weather. Pray that the weather's better on Friday.
All right. Amen. Sometimes if things don't go our way, sometimes God has a reason for things to change our plans. Yes. Brother, that was, it is getting baptized.
Was.
Was. Okay. Amen.
Carlos was his name. Let's keep him in prayer. He had a heavy heart on Sunday. Let's pray that God still deals with him. Amen. So we want to see another soul saved. We want to see another soul making it into heaven. Amen. Praise God. We have a city. Let's pray for our city. Amen. A lot of souls here that need God. Amen. And we are the light. We have to shine, amen, in this dark world. Amen. We have to do our job. Praise God. Let's stand and go to God in prayer tonight. Amen. Lord, you're awesome, God. You are awesome in this place. You are our Father. You are the one that has everything under control, God. We come to you, God, because you are the one that's able to fix the brokenness part of this world, in our lives, in our families, God. You're the one that's able, Lord, to turn our nights into the morning, God. Our prime instruments to dancing, God. You're the one, Lord, that we come to, Lord. Lord, when all else is Lord, fails, God, in our lives. Lord, we're looking to you, God, for our hope. We're looking to you, God, in our times of need right now, Lord. All the families, God, that are struggling in this world, this virus, God, that is running rampant in this world. Lord, we know, God, that you are able, Lord. Don't you believe us of it? But if you know, Lord, we know that you are able, Lord, and that you are God that's above all things, God. Lord, you created all things, and everything that happens, Lord, we know about God. Lord, we love you tonight. We know, God, that you love us. You have died on the cross for our sins, God. You have given us a way, Lord, out of our sin problem. Lord, we thank you for that, God. Lord, bless all those, Lord, that are suffering from depression, Lord. All those in our city, God, that are homeless. All those that don't know which way to turn. Lord, we pray, God, that you would give them direction. Give them revelation, God. Turn on the light in their minds, God. Lord, so that they understand and know, Lord, that you are in control. Lord, we need you, God. Bless all those in Texas, God. All those that are going through this weather situation. Lord, I pray that your healing hand will be on the families that are struggling, God. Lord, I pray, God, that you would set answers. Open up doors for people, God. Lord, let them see that your glory, Lord, has come from you, God. Let them see that you are a living true God. And you hear their prayers. You are true to answer them, God. Lord, all they do believe in you, God. Lord, bless the internet's family, God. Parents, Lord, are looking for a home. Lord, I pray that you would give them, Lord, what they're looking for. I pray, Lord, that you would show them in such a way. Let them know, Lord, it was because of you, Lord, that you would give them that direction, God. Lord, bless us first, ladies, family, God, in your time. Lord, I pray that you bless our house, God. Lord, you know our need, God. I pray, Lord, Lord, that you would turn it around, God. Lord, I pray that the pain that they had, Lord, that you would take it away. Let them know, God, that it came from you. Lord, we love you, Jesus. Bless Uncle Carlos today, Lord. Lord, he's in a hospital, God, he's with COVID. Lord, you are merciful and mighty. And we know, God, you are victorious in all your ways. We need you, Jesus. Lord, hear our cries. Hear our prayers, Lord. You're the only one that's able to reach in and take care of our needs. We thank you, Jesus. And we pray all these things in your mighty name. That name that's given to us, whereby we must be saved by. Oh, that wonderful name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your love and your mercy. And all of you. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you,
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. The Bible says, who always gives us the victory.
Right.
Amen. We know that all things work together for the good of them that love God and are called according to his purpose. Praise God. Praise God. Tonight we're going to continue with our series on prayer, the Lord's Prayer, and just kind of going through some aspects of that and it's cooperating now. Praise God. If you'll turn to your Bibles tonight, someone get Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to read through that, Matthew chapter 6, and I think verse number 9, I believe it is. You'll get that and read the Lord's Prayer, and tonight we're going to deal with the second aspect of this, try to get through as much as I can on the time that we've allotted for this. But if someone has that, Matthew chapter 6, I believe it starts at verse number 9 in Matthew. Yeah, if you read that, please.
After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Praise God. And so tonight, what we're going to, the aspect that we're going to, last week we, or 2 weeks ago actually, when we started with Our Father, which art in heaven. And we just called that the direction of prayer. My prayers go upward. My prayers don't go horizontally. My prayers don't go down. My prayers go up to somebody who's not in this world, who's not bound by things that this world binds its occupants by. Praise God. It's good to know that my God, my Father, you see, we addressed him in a relationship, not as some foreign person or somebody that we don't know, but our Father, somebody that cares for us. So when you utter those words, he's just really saying this is a family thing. When you start talking to God, and this is everybody. Everybody's God's child, because God made everybody. He wants a relationship with everybody. Not everybody's pleasing to him, but yet and still, God still has that fatherly love for everybody. And so in directing our prayers and our mindset, this is important. Your mindset when you pray is so important because it determines your level or your ability to have faith, how you perceive what you're doing and to whom you're praying, talking to. It's very important that we have that right mindset. But we covered that last time. And so tonight we want to go to the next part that says, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And there's something, there's a theme there, and I'm just titling this tonight, prayer. It's all about him. Praise God. When we start the prayer, we're acknowledging the direction of prayer, but then you see these next three items, they're all about him. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Praise God. We want your will to be done. Right. We want your purposes to be established.
Right.
But we're going to hallow your name. Now, the word hallowed means to make holy. It doesn't mean holy. It means to make holy. So there is an active participation required to treat this name with the utmost respect.
There you go. Yes, sir.
So that's what we're doing. We are making God holy. We are making God, it's a mindset. That's why the Bible says, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. David says in Psalms 34. But it's something that we have to actively do.
Right.
I need to see God. I need to make God larger than life because he is. I need to magnify him. What happens when you put something under a magnifying glass and you put your glasses on that may be bifocals? It lifts things up so that you're able to see it. It makes it bigger. And so when we magnify God, we are making him bigger. And so in our prayer, hallowed be thy name. We are building that name up. You know why we're building that name up? Because that name is our access point to God.
Yes, all right.
It's how we access him. It's how he's told us to access him, through his name.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes,
God. Why do we make it holy? John 14, 13 through 14 says this. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Verse number 14, if you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. And so the reason we want to elevate that name, the reason we want to hallow that name, the reason we want to set apart that name, the reason we want to consecrate that name, is because we want to make sure that we see God, that name is different from every other name.
Right.
Having the power to access God's power that can change whatever it is we're bringing to him.
Right.
That is so important.
Yes, it is.
It's so important. That's why Jesus put it here. He says, hallowed be thy name. We have to lift that name up. It's our job to lift that name up. When we enter prayer, your faith is going to be affected by your ability and by your active participation and lifting up the name of Jesus. Because if you think it's just a common name like every other name, it's not going to do anything for you. But when you see the name of Jesus as more powerful, when you magnify the name of Jesus, all of a sudden, When you start asking things in that name, you've already magnified it.
Right.
All right. Yes, sir.
And you've lifted God up, and so the problem that you're taking to him doesn't seem so impossible.
All right.
Yes. Praise God.
Yes, sir.
Now, Psalms 138:2 says something a little different. But I'll explain this in a second. It says, "For you have exalted your word above all your name."
Yeah.
Now, we're emphasizing the importance of hallowing that name. But he says he's exalted his word above his name. "Thy word, O God, is truth. It will last forever." The Bible says heaven and earth are going to pass.
Right.
What we see, what we know to be, everything. You know, in saying heaven and earth, it's encompassing everything that we understand life to be or our existence to have experienced. All of that's going to pass away, the Bible says. And the thing that's going to stand is the word of God.
Yeah.
And that's why. That's why he tells us, "My word I've exalted even above my name." My name is how you access me. But it's the word of God that gives us the faith to believe in what God can do.
All right, all right.
He says it. Amen. He says it. And because he said it, I believe it.
Amen.
There's nothing that can shake that.
That's right.
Praise God.
Yeah.
But we access him through his name, and we need to lift that name up. Proverbs 18 and 10 says, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower.
Yeah. Yeah.
The righteous runneth into it and are safe."
Yeah.
And is safe. I've quoted that, and you've heard it quoted many, many, many times. But have you ever stopped to think about this? So he says it like this. He says, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower." So now the picture you get is this, you know, this ancient-looking structure that's rounded, you know, almost like a lighthouse, you know. And at the top, perhaps, there's a place you can get out and look and everything. But you're highly elevated above everything on the ground that could disturb you. And the fact that you're not walking into that tower means there's a threat of imminent danger. How many get afraid when imminent danger comes?
Sure. Yes, sir. Yeah.
David said, at what time I'm afraid, I will trust in the Lord. Praise God. And so the image that he gives us is this tower that I run into. And nothing can harm me because I can get safe away from the elements.
Right.
If it's a flood, I get high up in that tower. I can get away from anything that could disturb me, could disturb my peace. Praise God.
All right.
Safety, protection, prominence. A tower cannot be hidden as it occupies prominence on the landscape.
All right.
The name of the Lord is the place I can go. You know, there's whatever's chasing me,
whatever's
bothering me, whatever ills me, I can run to that tower, the name of the Lord. And, you know, when you've elevated the name of the Lord, when you're in a practice of elevating the name of the Lord, when you're in a practice of that, when you're reading about how powerful his name is and what he's done in testimonies, the Bible says they overcame by two things, the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. When you are hearing testimony, when you are giving testimony to the greatness of God, you are indelibly marking in your mind how great that name is.
All right. Yes, sir.
Praise God.
Yes, sir.
They that know their God will be mighty and do exploits
because
they understand the power of it.
Yeah.
When somebody else will look at the name of Jesus and just think, well, it's just, okay, it's another name. It's not a big deal.
No.
When somebody has that image versus somebody that understands the power of accessing the name, things change.
Yeah, right,
things
right.
happen.
Yeah.
Situations can't stay the same because what's pushing it, what's driving it, is our faith
Absolutely.
In God. Our
Absolutely.
Faith in his name that he's given us.
Yes. Yes.
He's not given us an image to look at.
Jesus.
He's given us a name to call.
Yep.
Right.
Yes, sir. Yep.
Praise God.
Yes, sir.
A name that we can call on. The righteous can confidently run, not walk, into it because of threat of imminent danger. And it's accessed by calling on that name. Praise God.
Yes.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Psalms 46:1-3 says, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble."
Yes, sir.
A very present help in trouble. God is my refuge. Once again,
that whole image of the tower, running into that tower, my refuge, my protection, my safety,
yeah,
and my strength.
Yes, sir.
Praise God. I don't find strength in just myself.
Right.
And that's what gives me the ability to feel that I can face anything. I can face any foe. I can face any situation. It may cause me fear.
Yeah.
But when I back into that tower, when I run into that tower,
yeah,
when I start to use the name of the Lord,
yeah,
watch out.
Yes, sir. That's
things
right
have to change.
That's right. Amen.
Therefore, we will not fear though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, and the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. Praise God. I'm going to trust in the Lord. Psalms 145 and 18 says, the Lord is nigh or near unto all that call upon him.
Mm-hmm.
To all that call upon his name in truth.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Praise God. There's something about calling upon the name of the Lord that's so powerful and so simple. And you know, it's a natural reaction. When you're afraid, when you're a small child, mommy! You know, you go to your default setting, which is the person that you think can rescue you.
Yeah.
When Jesus is that person.
All right.
Yes.
When you have that kind of dependency on him and you call his name, he wants you to call his name.
Right.
It's not a sign of weakness.
Yeah.
Hey, Paul says, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Because I'm calling on the one that is my strength.
That's right.
God is my refuge and my strength.
Yes,
a very present help in the time of trouble.
Yes, sir.
Praise God.
Yes, thank you, Lord. Praise God.
Praise God.
Yeah.
That's a powerful truth to understand. But he says, hallowed be thy name. And God is wanting us to lift up and to exalt that name. It's so important that we lift up the name of Jesus. We get into the habit of doing that. You know, not every prayer you're going to start like that. Sometimes you're desperate in prayer, you just go to God and pray.
Yeah, yeah.
But if it's a scheduled prayer time that you have, you need to take some time and begin to exalt the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Tell him how good he is. You know,
right,
the thing about thanking God, the Bible says, I'll enter. Now, he's talking to us about how, you know, the Bible has this. There are certain instances where God is giving us a glimpse into how things work. And I believe the scripture where it says, I will enter into his gates with thanksgiving.
Yeah.
This is spirit. You know, we access God through the spirit, through our spirit.
Right.
And so we enter the gates in order to get into the presence of God. We enter that with thanksgiving.
All right,
and thanksgiving is forcing you to remember the goodness of God.
All right.
Mm-hmm. You're being forced to go back to that situation. You know, we experience life through the experience, not so much date and time.
Right.
We don't remember things in that way. But how we felt. You can think of events where you felt a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
Things that happened to you. You start to remember that, and how you felt soon becomes a part of that reality, and you can be right back there. That's why when we're talking about forgiveness, it's important to forgive not just one time.
Yeah.
Nobody can do that. Not on severe things. Nobody can just say, oh, I forgive, and just walk away. The deeper the severity, the more forgiving you have to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Because your memory's going to keep on bringing it up. You remember?
Yeah,
you remember?
Right,
but I remember. This is going to bring it up. That's going to bring it up. But you have to have a mindset that says, I'm going to forgive.
Yeah.
Right.
And you do it every time the memory brings it back up.
Right.
Or, if you take the bait, Satan will lead you right back there, and all of a sudden those feelings are back, and you were right where you started from.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
But it's important that God, you know, in entering into his gates, into his presence, we are to remember what he's done for us. In the same way, how you felt, how the relief you felt when you were facing something that you thought there was no answer for, and God changed it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah.
When you go back there in your memory, God says, I want you to do that.
Yeah.
And then begin to praise him. He says, then enter into his courts. Now, the king's palace had gates that you would enter. And then once you entered to those gates, you were in his courtyard.
Right.
So into his courts, the Bible says, we enter with praise.
Mm-hmm.
Praise, as you always hear me say, is calling God names in a good way. And it's based upon what he's already done.
All right.
In the Old Testament, they attached names to God that were indicative of what he had just done for them.
Yeah.
You know, when Abraham was about to to sacrifice his son Lot, when God provided that ram and bush, he says, Jehovah Jireh, the God that sees and will provide.
All right.
Praise God. So you begin to praise God and begin to thank him, give him names based on what he's done. Praise God. He's a healer.
Yeah.
And so when you start to go into your prayer, your request to God, you have already set the stage by saying, he can do this. He did that. He can do this.
Right.
You see how it propels that momentum.
Yeah.
Gets you into prayer that's powerful. Praise
right.
God.
Amen.
Amen.
Because yes, you believe that what you're doing is actually not just an exercise in futility,
right. Yeah.
But something's going to change.
Yeah.
Praise
right.
God. And, yeah. and God... in his word, it's scattered about. The Bible says here a little, there a little, but the way in which we access his presence and get the power, you know, that's meant for us. Meant for us. Praise God.
All right.
Hallelujah. Okay. Then he says, thy kingdom come.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, hallowed be thy name. Next, your kingdom come. He's not asking for anything about himself so far.
Right.
It's important to understand that. If there are times that you're going to come in prayer, and you're, like I said, those are times that it's desperate. But in your routine prayer, where you're praying to God, and this is the time that I set to come before God, you need to lift God up in your mind. And the Bible tells us how to do that. Thanksgiving, praise. Praise God. So he says, thy kingdom come. Now, the Bible says in Romans 14, 17, someone get that for me and read what it says about the kingdom of God. Romans 14 and verse number 17. I'll give you a backdrop really quick. He's talking about, eating things that were offered to idols and drinking things that are offered to idols. And he's saying, really, idols aren't a god. And that's not what the kingdom's about. But he does tell us what it's about. Someone read that, please.
For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost.
It's righteousness and peace and joy and the Holy Ghost. Because his kingdom, Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world.
Right.
It's not a carnal thing.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not something that the human eye can see. He's going to say that in one of these examples that we're going to talk about here. So Jesus, throughout his ministry, talked about the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven, as Matthew puts it. But he says... it's like a treasure in Matthew 13, 44. Someone get that. It's like a treasure that's worth selling everything for. Praise God. Someone get that. Matthew 13 and 44.
Then again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth. And for joy thereof, goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field.
It's worth selling everything you have for. In other words, it's worth you selling out. It's worth you putting all your all into getting it. That's why Jesus says, if you have to forsake houses, not everybody has to do all this, but if you have to forsake houses, land, mother, father, sister, brother, whatever it is, you've got to get the kingdom of heaven.
That's right. Amen.
You've
got
to get
right.
into the kingdom
right.
of heaven. It's that valuable.
Amen.
It's that valuable. You know, it's past. You know, sometimes you look at the obituaries and you see people of all ages. If you look at it for a week, that's a morbid thing to do and probably not the thing that's going to cheer you up in any given day. But if you were to look at the obituaries for a week, you will find every class of age.
Yeah.
And it's amazing. We are not promised a day on this planet.
That's right.
It is all about eternity. So we're in testing grounds for eternity. And God is the ultimate timekeeper. He knows when every heart is going to expire. He knows that expiration date. And we just have to make sure that we're living, everything that we're living, everything that we're doing is pointing in one direction. I'm going to walk on streets of gold. When you don't think that's true, you will live any kind of life.
Yeah.
You will do any kind of thing.
Yeah.
And there are many people that are living any kind of life,
right.
doing any
right.
kind of thing. And when you
right.
talk to them about God, they'll say that I don't believe he exists.
Yeah.
Right.
That's true.
But the Bible says the fool has said
right.
in his
right.
heart
right.
there's no God.
Right.
Because
right.
everything in his
yeah.
life is screaming to him
yeah.
about the reality
yeah.
that he's trying to deny.
That's right. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
So he says, a mustard seed.
Yeah.
The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed.
Yeah.
Someone read that in Matthew 13:31-32. You'll see many of them are in that chapter. Not all of them, but many of them.
Another parable put ye forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like to a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds. But when it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs, and becometh a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof.
He says, you know, I this draws my attention. He says, it's the least or the smallest of the seeds.
Yeah.
He compares the kingdom of God as the least or the smallest because it starts off small. But the effect that this message, this freedom for mankind, the effects of this message have spread the world wide.
Right.
The Bible is the most read book. Yeah. It's still the most popular seller. Mm-hmm. After all these years, all kind of books have come out. Nothing tops it. Mm-hmm. Because there's a yearning in the heart and soul of every man to know God.
Yeah.
God came in the most effective way,
right?
Knowing the most effective way to reach people, God used it. Praise God. And when God's done, he's going to get the most souls that are possible to get from this world. A lot of people are going to miss it. We know that. Have missed it. But God's methods, his wisdom, think about it. God is employing wisdom on reaching souls. And so when everything is said and done, when it's all finished, the most possible souls that could have been saved will be saved.
Amen.
It's our hands, it's our feet, it's us that do the work.
Right.
And that's how God's designed it. But at the same time, it starts off small, but it grows. That should give every one of us. That should thrill every one of our souls.
Right.
Because we're fishers of men.
Right.
And what he's saying is that it may start off small, but it's going to grow.
Amen.
It's going to get bigger. It's going to get powerful.
Amen.
So what we're feeling on inside, that we're going to reach this city, it's going to happen. Praise God. Because he says, this is how it works. You sow seeds. They that go out sowing seeds, weeping, shall doubtless, the Bible says, come again, bringing their sheaves with them. It works. It works. You may have to sow for a long time, but there is a reaping coming.
Praise God.
Praise God. There's a reaping
Amen.
Coming.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
There's another one. He says it's also like leaven or yeast. And he says also it's like a banquet. Someone turn to Matthew 22. That's kind of lengthy reading, but someone tackle that can read kind of fast. But I just want to get to the point of it all. Matthew 22:2-4, 14 rather.
The kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king, which made a marriage for his son, and sent forth his servants to call them that were bidden to the wedding, and they would not come. Again, he sent forth other servants, saying, tell them which are bidden, behold, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fatlings are killed, and all things are ready, come unto the marriage. But they made light of it, and went their ways, one to his farm, another to his merchandise. And the remnant took his servants, and entreated them spitefully, and slew them. But when the king heard thereof, he was wroth, and he sent forth his armies, and destroyed those murderers, and burned up their city. Then saith he to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which were bidden were not worthy. Go ye therefore into the highways, and as many as ye shall find, bid to the marriage. So those servants went out into the highways and gathered together all as many as they found, both bad and good, and the wedding was furnished with guests. And when the king came in to see the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment. And he saith unto him, friend, how comest thou in hither not having a wedding garment? and he was speechless. Then said the king to the servants, bind him, bind his hands and feet, and take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.
That's the observation. Many are called, but few are chosen. And, you know, in this particular parable, he goes through, quite the history of the kingdom of God, you know, in terms of what God has done to reach mankind. Some rejected. They killed the prophets. They killed the disciples. And, you know, the people that he came to, the Bible says he came to his own, and his own rejected him.
Right.
But to all that will allow him to make them into the sons of God, he's whosoever will.
Yeah.
And so he tells us to go into the highways and the byways and to compel people to come.
Yeah.
And then he shows us a picture of somebody that ends up there at the marriage supper. And he doesn't have the right clothes on. He's there, but he doesn't have the right clothes on. And at the judgment, you know, there's a little place where Jesus says, let the wheat and the tares grow together. He says, don't bother until the end. I'm going to come with my sickle in hand, and I'm going to separate them. A lot of people think that just being a good person is good enough, but God is very specific about what he says to do. And so he just shows us in this parable that God is going to sometimes wait till the end, and at that point do his separation. So he said the kingdom of heaven. He gives us a wide view of much of the kingdom of heaven. Luke 17 and 20 and 21 says, it's not by observation of human sight, but the kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of God coming is the Holy Ghost on the inside of us.
All right.
Praise God. That's how, when we are baptized in his name, we're filled with his spirit, we are joining the kingdom of God. We are part of the kingdom of heaven. Praise God. The Bible says that we are ambassadors. This world's not our home. We're ambassadors. Praise God. We've been given the ministry of reconciliation, reconciling a lost world to a loving God.
Jesus.
Praise God. That's our job. That's what God has commissioned all of us to do.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
And the next thing he says, thy will be done. Now there's a scripture that encapsulates the will of God. It's 2 Peter 3 and 9. Someone read that. This really gets to the heart of the matter of what God's will is by saying it in the opposite way towards the end of that verse. Someone read that. 2 Peter 3 and verse number 9.
The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, Lord, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
He's not willing. His will is not that any should perish. But his will is that all might come to repentance.
Yeah.
Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Now, in heaven, God's will works.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever God says goes. The Bible says about Satan, he says, you were perfect. Lucifer, you were perfect in all your ways until iniquity was found in you. You know, here's the thing I say about Satan. He never had a bad day. He was created perfect. Never had a bad day. Nothing ever went wrong. And he still messed up. So when he got lifted up in pride, the Bible says that Jesus says, I saw Satan descend from heaven like lightning. As soon as he rose up and said, I will sit in the seat of the Most High. I'm going to basically kick God out, and I'm going to take over God's kingdom. Even though God made me, it was stupid, but pride does that to you.
Yes, it does, bro.
Pride does that to you. Yeah. You talk stupid. You say things that don't make sense because you're elevated in yourself.
Yeah.
And that's why the Bible says God resists, not because he hates anybody, but because he doesn't want you to go to the place that Satan's going. Because the thing that got a hold of Satan that messed him all kind of up is his pride. The Bible says God resists. He pushes. He fights actively, pushes against the proud. But he gives grace to the humble.
Yes, God. Thank you.
Thy will be done
in
earth. And this is what we need to pray every day.
God, let your will be done in my life today. All the circumstances, all the situations I'm going to encounter, let your will be done. But you know what? If God's will is going to be done, somebody's will is going to have to sit in the back seat, right? You have a will. I have a will. And so there has to be a determination to make my will take the back seat. It's not a natural thing. Because we always want to be assertive. We always want to... The Bible says the carnal man is at enmity. I mean, he's an enemy of God. He's at the battle. He's fighting against the Spirit of God, our carnal nature. Yeah. But the Bible says that through the Spirit, we mortify or kill the deeds of the flesh. And that means we subdue our own flesh. Praise God. Thy will be done. That's a power-packed statement. It's something we'd be willing to do. In earth. In my life. In my surroundings. As it is in heaven. Yeah. I'm surrendering. So, you know, we're talking about all these things. We're elevating his name. We're saying, God, we want your kingdom, your purpose to be established. And I'm yielding my will to allow yours to be done just as it is in heaven.
Yes.
On earth. Amen. Praise God. Let's stand tonight. Prayer is all about him. Right. When we enter prayer, we are elevating him. But you know what? In doing all of that, we're benefiting ourselves.
Yeah, that's right.
Because you'll find immediately after this, we start talking about our needs. See, God's not, he understands that, you know, there has to be a motivation. There has to be some give. He's willing to give. He says it throughout his word. He says, you ask anything in my name, I'm going to do it. But there are some things that precede that in importance. Whether I get the things that I need in this life, that's not as important as me walking streets of gold. As opposed to the alternative. You know what I'm saying? Think about that. The alternative is to be in misery and pain and all that stuff. And it's true. It's real. But it's understanding and realizing that when I enter prayer, it's all about him. Because it's going to benefit me. It's something else how God does it. You know, we're praising him, but we're benefiting ourselves. And that is the understanding Jesus gave his disciples when he said, teach us how to pray. Praise God. Lord, we love you tonight. We're so thankful to you, God, for teaching us how to pray, for giving us this model, for giving us this example, for giving us your word, God, that's true. Everything else is going to pass away. Everything is going to have its time and its sun and then be done. But God, your word will not. Your word's going to endure, God. We can rely upon it. We can build our faith, our life, and everything about us. We can build that on your word that we know is sure. It's a sure foundation. It's solid, God. And we thank you tonight, God, for your love for us. We thank you for your peace that passes all understanding. We thank you for every promise that you've given us, every provision you've made for us, everything that you've said to us, Lord, to give us hope, Lord, and peace, Lord, in the future. Have your way, Lord, tonight, Lord. Touch us, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Help us to draw closer to you, God. Help our relationship with you to get better and stronger every day. Help us to talk to you, God. Help us, Lord, in our prayer life, God, to get closer to you, Lord, God, to understand you more better, Lord, to understand your power, God, to magnify, to lift you up, Lord, so we can see you as greater than any circumstances that we bring before you, Lord, God, to resolve. Have your way and touch us tonight. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's give God a hand of praise tonight because he's worthy to receive it. Hallelujah.